YouTubers, and welcome to this session of T4D, or Thought for the Day and Tip for the Day, number 6, if I recall correctly. In this session, I'm going to talk a fair bit about a few bits and pieces that viewers have posed in terms of the bits that I've gotten and buying them and how I get these bits and pieces. And that kind of also then leads into the kind of commercial or advertising side and the Amazon part of my channel, which I want to explain, as well as the new YouTube online store. Then what we will get into is discussing the layout of my new bench, kind of how it's ergonomically is going to help me a fair way, and I'm going to try and describe some of the benefits of what I've done, where it's perhaps lacking. So if you're going to do this for yourself, then perhaps you can gain a few tips from that. Then what we'll also climb into, and this is kind of intro into the kind of electronics side and making circuits and the electronics tutorial, is a discussion about the few bits and pieces, the new solder station I've got, the tools for soldering and what have you. What I will do, as there's going to be a fair bit of talking now up here, I'm going to post the time you can jump to if you want to get to straight looking at the kind of discussion about the bench and the electronic side, if you want to kind of skip over this initial discussion. Right, so the one thing is that people have kind of asked me, where do all the bits and pieces come from and what have you? And that kind of leads into the kind of, if you will, the kind of commercial side of what I do. So basically, most of the bits and pieces which I have and I review and I play with on my channel, I purchase myself. They come out of my own pocket in essence. However, when I decided to actually go full-time and make a serious go out of doing this channel, which was back last December, as I said, because I was laid off from my corporate job last April, tried a few things which didn't work out. I had this channel as a hobby on the side, which I really enjoyed doing. I thought, well, hey, I enjoy doing this. Why not do this full time? And one of the pushes to also do that was that Comptest, who are the agents for Fluke in Southern Africa, they found me in essence and looked me up, contacted me and said, can we bring bits and pieces for you to review? So of course that was of great benefit to me because, you know, it's not cheap having to pull out money out of your own pocket to buy these bits and pieces. So especially at the time as I was into doing a fair bit of Fluke kit, it was really handy that they were able to provide Fluke kit. Now Comptest aren't only agents for Fluke. You'll see I did that Calog calibrator and device for process control networks. They also do that line of stuff. That Medtronics charger that I did a review on in the last video, that also comes from Comptest. They are agents for Amprobe, so even the solar power stuff, what have you. So those bits and pieces get loaned to me. Fortunately, I don't have to buy them. I can then review them and then I return them back to Comptest. Now, even before Comptest came along, I was a Fluke fan. So it was certainly no problem. That's obviously one of the reasons why they contacted me. It's certainly no issue for me to talk about and rave on about Fluke because I really enjoy the product. I also do, and I warn them up front, I also do potentially have certain criticisms of, let's say, Fluke equipment, and I need to be able to freely air those when I come across them, which is what I do. And I also try and range, because I know some people find my channel and they see that when I'm talking about Fluke equipment, and they go, oh no, but an Extech can do this for half the price and what have you. And yes, in many cases it can. And that's why I do a broad range of reviews from the really cheapies up to the more expensive stuff, whether it's Fluke or whatever. I mean, my current favorite multimeter, as you might probably know at the moment, is the Metrics. It does lack in certain regards, let's say my Fluke 287, but as an all-round beastie that I enjoy using at the moment, it's my metrics, and I'm sure it will be for a long time, and its price point is very good. But that, let's just lead on then into the commercial side of the channel, because some questions have been raised there as well. Now, if I was Rockefeller, which I'm not, I would be doing what I do for free without the advertising, because I don't do this because I have to. I do it because I love doing what I'm doing. I love playing with the bits and pieces that I play with, and in essence, I just have the video camera to bring you along there for a ride. Obviously, it turns into a bit more of a serious thing when this is your daily focus task, but I would do it. I get annoyed by having to watch, whether it's television or stuff on the internet, and you get adverts popping up and what have you. But unfortunately, it's a necessary evil. This, what I'm doing here, in essence, for one, the money that the advertising generates goes to pay for the kit that runs the show. So for me, going out to buy bits and pieces to do the experimentation, what have you, takes money. If I was a psychologist talking about how to deal with breaking up with your boyfriend or what have you, guess what? I don't need to buy anything. But because this is my passion and the stuff that I do, in essence, I do need to buy bits and pieces. Besides buying the bits and pieces, because this is my essence, my day job, I say job, I don't see it as a job, it also needs to provide an income to put food on the table and a roof over my head. And therefore, that's why, and I often cringe when I say it, I say, you can go and buy this in my Amazon store. Because those bits and pieces help provide, ensure that this channel can provide an income for me. This channel certainly doesn't support me yet. It's got a long way to go before it gets there. I hope it does get there, because if it doesn't, it means I would have to seriously scale down what I do in this channel, because I'd have to be forced to find another source of income, which I don't want to do. So whether it's donations or by going and buying things on my Amazon store or anything on Amazon through my links or what have you, that supports me, brings in income. Just watching the videos brings in income. Rating them means they become more popular, more people get to see them. There's the going to my forum and my website, there's obviously advertising there. So that generates income. Then also, YouTube have now brought out, and I haven't mentioned this before, but YouTube have now jumped into the program, and they have a store which you can get directly from my YouTube channel. In fact, if you go to my homepage or my channel page, you'll see there's tabs at the top, and there's now a store. And this is something that YouTube have jumped into. There's also a link on the side, I think, and at the bottom. And although it's not fully, you can't buy any merchandise there, what you can do, you can buy music online from, it's either Amazon, iTunes, and someone else. You can buy concert tickets, which I haven't set up for because I just, it's out of my kind of interest area in terms of what concert tickets to sell. But and then there's movies or films or videos you can go buy. So what I have done, I've gone and picked a selection of, in fact, my taste and favorite music and my taste and favorite movies, because I thought, well, if it's going to be there, it may as well be something that I can relate to. So if you're interested as well, that's potentially another source of income. Then you can go and have a look at, just for interest's sake, potentially the films and the music that I enjoy, and it's there. And again, if you purchase it, it helps to go and keep the show on the road. It truly is, it's doing this kind of work, it's you have to learn to be like a filmmaker, a marketer, all sorts, to kind of run this. And as I said, what I'll do one day, I will do a whole video on a day in the life of a full-time or professional YouTube video blogger to give you an idea of what it entails. So again, I do, as I say, it's a necessary evil, and unfortunately it has to be there to support what I do. So in particular, when I jump into the electronics tutorials, like for instance, I'm going to set up a separate category on my Amazon store with perhaps all the basics I think would be handy for you to get started in electronics. whether it's the solder stations, solder, breadboards, helping hands, the things that I'm potentially finding handy on my bench, which may be of interest to those getting started. And again, the books and what have you, because again, it just does support what I do. So, I thank you for having to put up with all that. And I still hope that you do, because ultimately what I want to do is get down, do the videos and do some interesting things and research, which I find fascinating and I learn from, and say, hopefully coming along for a ride. Another thing in terms of my style and what I do and the people who watch this, I know I've been very fortunate. There are lots of really clued up professionals who watch my channel, who often chime in with advice, which I really, really appreciate. As you know, I'm in many ways a novice, a hobbyist, and I'm learning as I go along. And basically, I'm doing it for my own interest and learning experience, and then hopefully trying to pass it on to yourselves, because I've gained a lot from learning what's on YouTube and the internet. And it's certainly not a place for hotheads or know-it-alls. That's certainly not my approach. I think most novices and people don't like that, because you can be made to feel inferior. My approach is to try and grow and nurture people who are starting out and learning and what have you. And I've been fortunate in that there's loads of great people who know far more than I do, who jump in and either assist with more information or correct where I go wrong. And often that can happen. And constructive criticism or pointing out an error in a video that I make is always welcome, if it's obviously done in the right way. Like case in point, when I was the video with the oven, I can remember I was testing the potentiometer with the multimeter and saying that it's not linear, and there was a sudden jump in the reading of the multimeter. I've actually gone back to annotate, because someone pointed out and I hadn't realized, but the multimeter was auto-ranging at the time. And it's a silly error to make, but often when you're staring through the lens of a camera and what have you, you just don't pick those things up. So it's always handy to have those pointed out, and I'll always annotate, and if something goes atrociously wrong, I'll pull back a video, or I'll put a part B to say, made a mistake here, this is what should have happened, or what have you. Right, so enough of all that chat. I'm going to pick up the camera and actually do a quick walk around of how I put my bench together, and show you all the bits and pieces and perhaps how it can be improved. And then also I'll jump into and explain the new stuff I've got on my bench, and to lead into the electronic side and the electronics tutorial, I've got a little video snippet of me putting together this little electrical circuit. It's actually an electronic enigma machine. But I'll explain why I put it together and why I've got it. And basically it's operated by this keyboard. You connect a PS2 keyboard to it and you operate it. Let's jump in and have a look at the bench. Okay, so let's hope I can give you a fairly good perception of what's going on in the room with this bit of freehand camera work. So basically, as you know, I used to sit and work and do the videos at this bench over here. It certainly was a bit limiting space-wise. I did have a nice setup because I realized that having this shelf up here with the power supplies and everything at the top was really, it saved space on the actual desk, and I could use things down over here. But with the multiple projects that I kind of end up working on, it just becomes too cluttered and space was an issue. So that obviously led me then to kind of build this bench setup over here. Now, so the one thing I'd say to start off, I wouldn't recommend you build a setup like this underneath a suspended bed. Now, just to going back, if you haven't looked at a previous video where I kind of talk about my office space, I have this suspended bed up here, which I have a ladder up against sometimes. It's kind of, I put it up there as a nice chill out spot for myself. When I've got time to go and chill out, I can jump up there. It's out of the home, so no distractions from the family. That funny contraption on the roof, which can swing down. I can clip my little handheld computer or my Kindle on there and either watch video podcasts. To tell you the truth, these days, because I am so busy, I don't get time to really enjoy it, the space up there at the moment. But I didn't want to, I was thinking of actually raising it so that I'd have more headroom or what have you. but that would have been a fair bit more work and would limit the space at the top, and I don't want to take it away at the moment. If it really gets in the way, then I may, but I've worked out, the system I've worked out works out quite well underneath. What I did do, you'll see this black, that's actually pipe lagging, I put under here because obviously the risk of hitting my head as I get up is quite high, so at least I won't hit my head too hard. This leg over here, I've got something wrapped around so I don't cut myself on the corners of the leg. Then, this is chipboard, veneer chipboard, which I put up. I was thinking of doing it wall, literally from that wall right through to that wall, but the standard lengths from my hardware shop were 1.8 meters, so I just stuck to using the 1.8 meters, and it's meant basically that I could pull this old table, this desk that was sat over here, I can pull it, slip it right in there and still put stuff up there so that it's out the way or what have you. Now, I just used those kind of shelving brackets underneath, which are fairly strong, and I used raw bolts, and I don't know if you noticed in the time-lapse video, I used a pneumatic or rotary drill, and that's the one thing I can seriously recommend. I only discovered that later on in my DIY life was a rotary drill, and if you're going into concrete or hard stuff, it certainly makes a huge difference. It makes the work a lot easier. I've then obviously gone and put up some power strips, multiple power strips, so at least I shouldn't run out of power. Lighting potentially is still a challenge. Working in this area over here, as a normal person, the lighting's perfect. I've got there's a company, it's a South African company, I think, it could be Chinese, called Flash, which produces LED lights, which have got these rotating lenses, which is quite helpful because with the camera work, if the light is like shining onto a multimeter display, I can adjust it so that it's out the way or what have you. But for normal work, if you're not filming, the light is brilliant. It shines right down on here. I've got two back there. I've got that smaller one which is angled back to reflect off the wall. The challenge for me doing camera work is that they can potentially reflect in what I'm filming. So that is still the challenge I face. So what I did also was I stuck that piece of veneered chipboard up under the bed for two reasons. For one, I'm obviously thinking of having the bigger 6.5-digit multimeters under there, and just because they are electrical and might give off a little bit of heat, I didn't want that directly with the bedding material up underneath. I didn't want it directly going there, just thinking a little bit of fire risk and what have you, so I wanted something to disperse it underneath. But also the main reason I put it there was as a light reflector. Hence what I've just done today, you'll have noted in some of the filming, you were staring into that bright LED light that's up there. And all I've done now is I've got a piece of cardboard box wrapped tin foil around it to act as a reflector. So it reflects the light up there, so I get some indirect reflected light, which shouldn't be too sharp, coming down to the desk as well. And then at the back here, I've got another light strip where I can change the direction potentially on what I'm filming, so I get that right. But that's always a work in progress, is trying to understand the lighting. I mean, what I have done, like I've got that work light up there, which I use when I'm filming so that I get better light on myself, my face. The video I did with the Medtronic's charger, I actually forgot to switch it on. When I was looking at the video afterwards, I thought, you silly boy. But anyway, so that's the first two layers of the desk. I then also have my homebrew camera jib mechanism, which I've moved, which is a garden gate hinge, which I've screwed into the wall nice and firmly with my maneuverable spring arm with a magnifying glass, which I connect the camera to for the overhead shots. And that again has kind of worked out quite nicely here. I can put it right across over the area that I'm working in. I kind of take it up and down and extend the arm out and what have you. So that seems to be working all right. It would be nice to have a more
professional solution, but actually the Heath Robinson work there actually worked out fine. Then underneath, I used these quite heavy duty angles for the shelving. What I had to do, because I decided on having a larger top shelf, which was going to reduce the space I had between the top shelf and the bottom, I wanted a longer or a wider desk, and the width, the standard width, wasn't quite enough, so I added a leaf in the back. I added a strip of wood right to the back. So because that extended things out, I also decided if I'm leaning on the desk, those pieces underneath would not support the total length, so I did add these legs, which certainly give it a nice sturdy feel. So I've got the legs on there. So next, let me go into the kind of ergonomics. I've got my little chair with my little foam pad that I sit on, and I come sit down, and I must say, as you'll see from the video snippet when I was doing some soldering work, this space and the way things are laid out here in front of me works really well. I've got now all the kind of oscilloscope, my two power supplies, the little bench multimeter and what have you, all within reach, all in kind of an arc around me, so it's easy to get to. The solder station I can easily pull over in front of me and work with soldering work here. Then the one thing I would say, if I really had the freedom of choice, it would be handy almost to perhaps either have, this is going to sound bizarre, have like a curved desk around you, because if you're working on so many bits and pieces, you always want them within hand's reach, ideally. And a curved desk where you could like put things there and move around would be great. Or if you could set up in a corner and have like the desk going either side and like a rounded point over there where you're sitting, then you've got the two desks going off to the side. That might be a handy setup. I suppose it might be limiting in terms of the big spread space, but it's just something to consider if you are thinking of actually putting your own bench together. I know someone mentioned they were thinking of doing it, so that's, I thought I'd just kind of point that out. So as you can see, I've kind of got my screwdrivers and everything up on the wall there within relatively easy reach, so I can get to those. I've got my leads for my multimeters over here, and that I might move because that's a little bit of a reach, a stretch. So there's still a work in progress in terms of improving things to make it work. Also, I had like the little cup hooks on the end of there to hold the little crocodile crips. I haven't moved that yet, so I might want to move that again. So if I'm working here, they're within easy reach. So there's still a few bits and pieces to do, but certainly it does the job. Anyway, let's have a closer look at these bits and pieces. Okay, so while we're doing a whole little background into the room and the kind of the setup, from the filming point of view, and it's something you might or might not have noticed, a subtle detail. Obviously for the overhead shots, I use that kind of boom, but obviously sometimes I need to use tripods. And I was using these cheaper, I can certainly recommend these kind of cheap Sunpak Compact SXL tripods. They're cheap, and they're actually, if you just need a quick solution, they work reasonably well. But what I noted was when you are trying to pan or tilt, there's that little bit of a jump because it's obviously stiff. And that was starting to annoy me when I was filming. So what I have got, and again, this is the cheapest entry level fluid head, and I bought it locally. It's called, Velbon. But this in essence has oils in the head, which you could adjust for nice smooth movement. So certainly some of the last videos I've been doing, although you might not have noticed it, when I pan around, at least it doesn't start off with a jerk. I've got a nice smooth movement when I'm actually doing the filming. Anyway, let's jump into the solder station and what have you. Okay, so as you'll know, with the project I'm doing with the multimeter precision reference and what have you, I've landed up with some surface mount components, which I thought might be a challenge, and there have been quite a few people chiming in with handy advice. I've got some adapters which I'm going to solder the surface mount stuff on so I can put them on PC boards. Also, what I do want to highlight, someone recommended, and I thought he might have them, is good old Dave Jones has some tutorials on how to select tools for soldering, and a tutorial on soldering, and he ends up doing a tutorial on surface mount stuff, and that's certainly, watching that, gave me a lot of confidence to think about tackling it. But what I wanted to do, because I had an older plug-in type soldering iron, was for the surface mount stuff, I wanted a little more control in terms of the temperature and what have you. So I decided to get a few bits and pieces to make that work easier, and certainly the one piece I've invested in is the solder station. Now, the one thing Dave Jones says, and I kind of I'd certainly second what he says, but I've gone the other route. He says certainly what you should do is buy a known name brand like Weller or what have you, who do solder kit. And I totally agree with that, but I decided to take a chance. This is an RS Components branded solder station. I went for it because it just seemed quite, it's got an LCD screen, and I just love LCD screens. The reason I went for it is because it does have digital control. Basically, you can switch it on, you can digitally set your temperature. You can see it tells you that the power range here, and it actually has temperature measurement of the tip. So the nice thing is, as you switch it on, you can actually see what temperature when your soldering iron is ready to work with. You don't have to guess. So you can let it sit there, and you've got some default temperature ranges that you can set with these buttons. You can manually go up and down by each degree for what you want to set it to, and it's got an automatic power down. So once it reaches, I think it's set for around 350 degrees at the moment, once it gets there, you'll actually see the power bar come down. As you start working and start cooling the tip, the power obviously pops up and starts heating the tip again. And I'll try and do a kind of more in-depth review on this, but so far from the work that I've done, the little bit of soldering I did on the circuit, it has worked a charm. I do have some little criticisms about it. There you can go, as you can see, when it's reached its temperature, the power bar goes down, and then it kind of alternates to maintain that temperature. The cradle for the soldering iron, I wish was a little heavier, but nonetheless, it does the job. But the one thing I noted, like the sponge, it's got this metal piece in the front here. So obviously when you're cleaning your soldering iron, just watch out the cable, if you touch the front here, it's fine because there's a plastic surround. But naturally, if I'm soldering with my right hand, I might want to sweep across this way, and I've already done it and touched, and basically you potentially melt or mark the plastic over there. So I might put some metal trimming right around here to improve that. Right, to bring you back to the other bits and pieces then I've got which assist. I went and bought a whole range of new, I've had some old kind of pliers and side cutters for my work, but they have become blunt, and you certainly, if you are going to be working on PC boards and placing components, having a set of good flat side cutters to trim off your through hole stuff and what have you makes the job a lot easier. Having little pincers to place components and hold components, or particularly if you're desoldering and you want to pull components out, they're very helpful. Also, this is a tip, I know Dave mentions it, but when I went and last bought solder, the guys, I was like probably after trying to buy like a millimeter solder, and don't. Buy 0.5 of a millimeter and less. Rather, you have far more control doing neater solder work and finer solder work doing this. Even if you're not doing fine solder work, well, then you just use more, but it gives you that control. So having a nice 0.5 or less solder certainly helps. Obviously, when you need to desolder, one of these suckers works well. I do also, there's something I've not used before, but wicking material helps you desolder, heat up and desolder, get rid of solder splash and what have you. So I've yet to really put that to test and try it out. Then what I have got, I've had these helping hands, these little helping hands which you've bound to have seen before, which can be quite handy when you're working on a component or a piece of wire. I did use them for working on this PCB, but I have ordered a panner vise to kind of hold PCBs in place when you work on them, because I think that'll be a lot easier. That those helping hands certainly aren't the best for that kind of work. Then the one thing that's perhaps missing is an extractor. The fumes, I will perhaps put up a simple PC fan to blow the fumes away, because it's something you need to be wary about, especially if you're using lead-based solder. You don't really want to be inhaling that solder smoke. And then obviously I've got my anti-static mats now, and I've got an anti-static wristband, so I'm going to be handling surface mount devices, then potentially electrostatic discharge can kill your components or damage them, so that's what I do there. Right, let's jump into this and why I put this together. Okay, and as this video I'm sure is going to be running on quite long, I'm going to do a very quick time-lapse-y, just showing you where I do a little bit of soldering work on this, while I tell you why I chose to do this. The reason I decided to get this Enigma project underway. Now, Enigma, if you don't know, was a mechanical encryption or encoding device used in the Second World War. And this is kind of an electronic version of that. So I've always been intrigued by encryption and encoding and what have you. So that was my reason for getting it. Why did I get this little circuit board? I wanted to test out my solder station. I wanted to just start honing up on my soldering skills, because it's not something that I often do. So that was the whole rationale behind it. And to do that, also, it's also good to have a nice little project that interests you when you're doing it, so that you've got a good end goal. And again, I keep on highlighting that, even with the Arduino stuff. Don't just try to start learning something if you don't have an enticing or interesting end goal for yourself, or else potentially it's going to become boring and you might drop out. Rather have an enticing end goal, because it's going to make you want to learn and follow through with the tutorial and the learning. And that's why I've picked this. It's something we will probably have a closer look at when we do the electronics tutorial, to understand all the components on here and maybe even have a closer look at this chip and what it does, because I don't even know yet what that does. So that's the reason I got it. I also got it because it's got that keyboard attachment, and what I might do, I'm keen to actually hook up so that I've got a better handle for my next tutorial on the oscilloscope to hook that up and capture signals coming from the keyboard to this, because that's something you can use an oscilloscope for. And it'll help me correctly understand the correct operation of that oscilloscope, because I have finally got this weekend made the time to go and collect the actual user manual. So hopefully I can go through this and understand the capturing and the trigger and all that kind of bits and pieces when I do that tutorial. Anyway, hopefully I've covered all the bits and pieces before this video runs too long. So let's wrap it up quickly.
Okay, I hope you managed to hang out to the end of this video. I hope it gives a little more insight into one kind of the kind of commercial side, and why I keep on need to go on about rating the videos and my Amazon store and all that kind of thing, because it is literally what keeps the show on the road. I hope the little tour of the bench and what have you and the bits and pieces there was helpful. If you have any queries or what have you, or want to ask anything more about it, or perhaps make any suggestions, because I said this is going to be an ongoing work in progress. I'll try and improve things in terms of lighting for when I do the videos, and making it a more functional workspace. And if you happen to say, Martin, what about this or what have you, post a comment. Also, as I said, it's very handy. My forum is a great place for having an interactive conversation because there's far more people who can see that conversation and chime in if they need to. I also remind you about the multimeter giveaway for the end of July. So that's the MajorTech MT1887. If you hadn't seen from the previous video, I'll put a link down below referring to that, and you can go to my forum and answer a few questions, and then hopefully you can, if you're lucky enough, you can win the multimeter. Someone actually chimed in and said, would I send it to some part of the world? I'll send it anywhere. It doesn't matter where you are, whoever wins, I will post it to wherever you are. So don't let that hold you back from entering. So again, I thank you very much for watching. Just purely watching, rating supports what I do. So please do, if you gain any value, give it a thumbs up. And I'll catch you soon next week for a continuation of the project, the calibration project. And then very soon, I hope to be receiving both the Fluke and the HP Agilent 6.5-digit multimeters for us to play with and have a review on those. And then the electronics tutorial will start soon as well. Cheers, catch you soon.